Yes, so the name of this presentation is a fourth try at implementing total quality management in public administration. Now, today there are lots of visions of an agile public sector. That's quite not surprising, I would say. The world is getting more complex and public sector needs to adapt in a smooth and flexible manner. But also, I think it's important to notice that agility is the latest could be seen as the latest management fashion, following on the heels of lean business process reengineering, total quality management, and so on. But although these fashions are more or less based on the same theories, methods, and tools, they always emphasize something that is perceived as a major challenge of the time, as Abramson says, like today's concern with complexity, which is of course very, very real. So we need to have this. So it makes sense to focus on this small step, smooth and agile approach. However, from the viewpoint of the European Quality Award and EFQM Business Excellence Model, agility is simply an aspect of total quality management. What I mean by this is that although agility is now presented as something new and revolutionary, it's from the quality management perspective, is just one aspect of the wider thing that when we talk about quality culture and how to succeed, it's certainly extremely important, but it's one dimensional one aspect of it, and that is what I try to illustrate here, showing what how to improve quality, efficiency, and flexibility. At the very top here, at the strategic level, we have the things like the EFQM Quality Business Excellence Model, concerned with organization and culture, things that are extremely difficult to change but are enormously important. In order to change them, you often have to work with the management systems, which is why, and in the quality and world of quality management, that is typically represented by the ISO 9000 quality management system standards. To avoid that these standards are this management systems is implemented in a bureaucratic and hopeless manner, it's also important to work with the processes and improve the processes, so they're not making the organization more bureaucratic, but we are trying to make it more lean and more precise. And at the level beyond there, I have written a work assignment, because that is where the external consultant or the internal consultant or anybody inside the organization is given some type of work. It could be you can think of that as a project, whether it's to improve to do EFQM assessments, work on culture, whatever it is. In practice, the assignment is defined at this level, at the project level. It's something that is typically limited in time and scope and cost. And what it means for the individual working in this, been giving this project, he has to work on his personal efficiency and quality, and that's why I use this popular framework, Getting Things Done, GTD, by David Allen from 2001 here, in order to represent how to professionalize or how to work really efficiently with the daily tasks. But the question at the bottom here is, how can one individual influence the total culture of a given organization? So that is represented by this arrow going from the bottom of the pyramid up to the very top. Of course, there are also challenges in theoretical and cultural challenges. You cannot just enter the organization and try to change it without really understanding it. The vision of agile organization is challenged by culture, incompetence, and power games. At least that has been my experience working with these kinds of problems for 30 years, and also what I see in most of the in the literature in general. Now I'm going to read this very quickly. This passage at the middle here from the book by Anderson Spicer, Functional Stability. Because I want to emphasize the the stupidity paradox, as I think is a very interesting thing. Functional stupidity can be catastrophic. It can cause organizational collapse, financial meltdown, and technical disaster. And there are countless more everyday examples of organizations accepting the dubious, the absurd, and the downright idiotic, from unsustainable management fads to the cult of leadership or an over-reliance on brand and image. And yet the dose of stupidity can be useful and produce good short-term results. It can nurture harmony, encourage people to get on with the jobs, and drive success. This is how Alderson and Spicer define what they call the stupidity paradox, saying that on the one hand, the stupidity is extremely detrimental and causing collapse of organizations. On the other hand, a little bit of our stupidity can be useful for the internal culture, for harmony, encourage people to get on with the. But this leads to, it's a paradox. So that is why I formulated the research question at the bottom here. Organizations jump on bandwagons like agility, lean, and TQM without understanding theories and cultural necessities. But can this, I ask, can this recipe for failure be utilized constructively in the manner suggested by the stupidity paradox? So that is what I would really, in this fourth attempt at looking at how to implement typical management in public organization, this is the paradox of the idea I would really like to look into this time based on my previous experiences. So let's return to this pyramid and how the different layers depend upon each other. I mentioned it briefly, but in the next few slides, I want to go through each of them in more detail, starting at the top with EFQM and the culture, and going gradually down as into the getting things done, daily personal productivity and daily tasks, and how these match together. So let's start with the ultimate goal. We call that the vision of an agile agile public culture, but it could also be called a TQM culture. Because when we talk about a TQM culture, like the Toyota culture, that is exactly where lean and agile and all those sorts of things are exemplified. That is the typical the model culture, the model organization that's referenced all the time. At this very top of the level, to have to measure the culture and organization, the usual way of doing that, making that more explicit, is to use the regional quality award models. We have the American Malcolm Baldrige Award, Japanese Denning Award, and in Europe and also areas outside of Europe, we use this model as seen here in different colors, the EFQM Excellence Model, or EFQM Business Excellence Model, as it used to be called. This is actually an early method. This is an early model. This is a model how it looked like from 1992 until 2019, but I think it's easy to understand it. The logic is the same in the new version, but it's easier to understand the logical model by looking at this, how it was originally articulated. On the left side, on the red and yellow, we see the enablers of success. Leadership, people management, and things like that. And on the right side, we have how we measure the results of how we measure total quality management results. People are happy, the customers are happy, society is happy, and the key performance in results like business results or public sector results. Also, an important part of the enablers is the green one, the processes. This is, in fact, this is extremely, this is perhaps more important than anything else in those, and has been in most of the models been given a higher weight than the other ones, because that is how you can change by changing the processes, changing the management system is the most efficient way of changing the culture. So that is how the ISO 9000 system, why it plays such an important role in the implementation of quality management, in total quality management. here we see the model espoused by the ISO 9000 standard. You see that it's they have structured the different requirements along this model, this cycle: plan, do, check, act, or continuous improvement, and making sure that the organization as a whole and all aspects of the organization are going through are not only reaching compliance but are also continually improving in all sorts of ways. But as pointed out in the book on the bottom right here, Lean ISO 9001, it also matters how the processes are being defined and managed. And because we don't want to create an incredibly efficient bureaucracy, we want to create, if you're using things like the Toyota culture and Toyota, we want to make sure that everything's smooth. It's as cheap, as fast, as cheap, and as high quality as possible. So that is why this lean process management is important, to integrate those three in. So, and here are the here is the lean thinking, how that lean principle, final lean principle, defined in this book in 1996. And you look at the process, start by defining the value, what are the customers interested in, then they map out the value stream, how it goes through the various stages, by focusing on what is creating value at each of those stages. Then they make the production and the assembly line, the sort of thing that flow in a smooth manner. We make sure that we establish a pull system, meaning that we are not producing. We are producing in correspondence with what the customer is pulling, and then we are pursuing perfection, trying to make this process smoother and smoother by eliminating everything that is unnecessary waste. The same principles or similar ideas or related ideas can be found in process management ideas based on agile is also and business process reengineering, also often called business process management today, and Lean Six Sigma. However, I point out at the bottom here how a process improvement happens typically project by project. So it's not automatic. So in like this plan, do, check, act project, so we need to get involved in the right projects. So project management, and yes, the plan, do, check, act projects are important to define that we're planning a project, we're doing it, we're checking it, and we are responding to the checking, seeing whether thing improved, and then we have this act. Should we do we have to do it again, or can we move on to something different and improve that? And I've included a book here on the art of consultancy, because project management is not only the technical aspects of planning, doing, checking and acting, but there are also political aspects and how to make that. And from what I've seen, at least, the consultancy literature is very good at describing this, and they are typically working with this. This is how they survive, by getting good and getting inside organization, carrying out project and getting out and so on. So that is the art of consultancy. I think as considered a relevant reference here. To emphasize that perhaps even more strongly, getting involved with the right project and managing them will require consultancy skills. And how do you build such skills? One way of doing it is to focus on how to improve personal quality and efficiency. And a very popular book for the past 25 years almost is this Getting Things Done by the Art of Stress-Free Productivity by David Allen, where he argues a flowchart model like this. many people use nowadays, which also is based in the same ideas, in lean and agile ideas. An important thing I want to stress here is about the only thing we can control is our own workflow. We cannot control, we can try to control the project, of course, if we're given the responsibility. But at some point, somebody in management organization suddenly decides this project should be terminated. So we do not have full control of that, but our own work processes, this is where we have, there we are, at least we have full control to try to work as professionally, as efficiently with us as possible. So in the methods I have been using in my research, the Bootstrap algorithm, this is the what I believe is the best place to start, because this is the foundation, the absolute foundation for building and implementing total quality management culture by adopting the total quality management ideas for oneself in one personal quality and efficiency. So this is what the action plan looks like. I'm planning to start in October, and I'll continue to work for almost 3.5 years until I reach the age of early retirement at the age of 62. Because this is, of course, a extremely stressful organization to work project to work with, to work against the grain, sort of, and look at the this stupidity paradox thing, you know, it's not easy. So what is new this time? This is, as I said, this is the fourth attempt. The first attempt from 1999 to 2005, that was something that worked very well in the beginning, but ended in a disaster due to organizational politics. Then I did a second attempt, which also failed for same reasons. Not exactly the same reasons, but once again, it was organizational politics, issues outside my personal control that made it. And then I did a third attempt, all these times working from in different, very different settings. But once again, the failure was due to organizational politics and how I did not have control over what I was trying to do. So it was a stab in the back, or was what you say, it was political issues. So this is why the fourth try will focus exclusively on self-improvement by using the Getting Things Done framework, as I said, trying to stay immune to organizational politics, and to make that a little bit more explicit, and what I hope to be able to discuss here, how to make this journey more explicit, is that this is a kind of assumption here, managed by, I refer to this book, managed by Morons, Morons. Because it's not possible in this kind of organization, it's not possible to choose your own your manager or leader, given somebody to work for. And occasionally, at least I have experienced that several times, that I have very, very difficulty respecting or understanding what this person is trying to achieve. But as I propose here, by blindly following in the boss, regardless if he or she is a moron, getting incredibly good at doing projects that are meaningless, stupid, or detrimental to the organization, at least it should be possible to contribute to personal productivity research, which on this researching things like getting things done. And with a little bit of luck, what I hope, looking at the stupidity paradox on the right side here, a little bit of stupidity can be good, all the sudden spices it. So if if you can, these aspects of what they refer to as a short term, the long hanging fruits, the short term success, the creating harmony by just following, going along with the stream and doing the stupid things, perhaps that can create some kind of possibility where one can move up the TQM pyramid. Perhaps not, but at least it's worth investigating. So that is the topic for my research.